companies have to be held responsible. If you are taking care of, because it's not your data, ये तुम्हारे घर का photographs नहीं है, it is client data. I'm sure Mr. Jadhav would agree on that. It's not your data, it's not mine, it's the company's, it's a public data. So you are, you hold it, you are responsible for the data, you bloody well tell the people that you have lost the data or the data has been compromised. And once that feeling comes into place, companies by default get serious about data security. Otherwise, even now in ransomware, it is very rampant in the industry. And what happens is that we get so many calls from clients, from companies that, okay, we've been hit by ransomware, what to do, what to do? And they're jumping up and down, calling at 11 o'clock in the night. And we send, okay, we next day we tell them, okay, this is the way we're working and this is the statement of work and the proposal. After that, the company goes to sleep. Okay, then there is a wait and watch game. That's what we've seen almost in 90% of the cases. There's a wait and watch game. That is, okay, let us see if everything dies down, then you, why hire a consultant and waste money? Is it there in the backup? But nobody is bothered about how did the ransomware bypass your security and come in the first place. Now, and with regards to policies and procedures, again, I would agree with the panel. That is, we had, we have one of our key clients in the BFS. I cannot even take the segment name or the client name. Ransomware attack and their finance and treasury data was totally encrypted. We are their consultant and they pay us like a flat fee through the year. But for whichever reason, they didn't call us. And you know what they did? They ran an antivirus. Okay, for some people who understood what I meant, that's the last thing you should do if you're in ransomware. But they ran an antivirus. The antivirus cleaned the ransomware. And any chance that they had of any recovery of the data was gone. The entire finance and treasury data was wiped out. So, end of the day, even the backups were not tested out well. Some data was there, some data was not there. And in India, again, the cost of labor is not very high. So, okay, 15 days, we will rewrite the data sort of thing. That casualness attitude is there. So, if what Mr. Jadhav said, if that is implemented with a danda, which people and companies understand, they will take data security more seriously. I am sure you would agree. Anyway, they are still working on the laptop. No. I'm speaking of data flow analysis in the big data scenario. So, data leakage prevention techniques in big data. So it's technology. So, again, I use a BlackBerry because I believe Android is the most, not I believe, statistics say that it's the most buggy thing on the face of this planet and almost everyone sitting here is using it. So, I use a BlackBerry, I'm okay with it. Anyway. Quite a few of our clients. This almost looks like a reunion of sorts. So, anyway. Yeah. Yes, that again depends on what infrastructure you have in place and stuff. I'm sure BSE has everything. Now, again, if I may elaborate on what Mr. Godekar said, he's a very good friend of mine and we've been there with BSE too. He elaborated on SIEM. Now, I'm sure, knowing him, I know that he understands what an SIEM is all about. But for many companies, they have a log management system in place which is just consolidating logs and they feel that's a SIEM. Come on. It's not. Unless you have a correlation engine in place, it's not an SIEM. And there are many so-called outsourced SIEM providers who are nothing more than glorified log vendors. Who we can set up a free shift system in office and save a few lakh rupees every month. But companies like that, peace of mind, if you have SIEM, you don't have an SIEM unless you have correlation in place. If your log management engine is providing you number of failed logon attempts, that's rubbish. You don't need to pay so much money for that. It's almost like a con job that's happening, and I can see the gentleman sitting over here smiling because they know what I'm talking about. So there is, again, it falls on top corporates also, to have proper people like Mr. Godekar or Mr. Jadhav, Mr. Shukla, who actually know what technology all about. And they're happy sitting, paying a few lakh to con artists who are giving you outsourced log management engines on running on a free platform with absolutely no correlation or logic built into it. So anyway, so that's a few more things. It was very nice to hear you guys actually. And I'm still hoping for the systems to come on. So yeah.
service.
Yes, ransomware as a service. It could be RAS, you know, RAS, the new retake. Instead of RAS, the new take, it can become RAS, you know, ransomware as a service. The new business. Yes, yes, ransomware as a service. Yes, very true. But the thing is, it's brilliant actually. The entire concept, I was very, very, I cannot say happy about it, but it was brilliant, the entire concept of ransomware. In small way, yes. But nowadays it's becoming extremely more complicated also. It is learning to even encrypt network drives. Earlier it was only encrypting your local hard drives. Now it is spreading across the network. So if you have network drives or you are like an administrator and your system gets compromised, you are most likely compromising the data of for ransomware for the entire organization. So yeah, it's really scary sometimes. Oh yeah, I've got the gentleman sitting over here. He's an ACP sitting over there. Yes, the Assistant Commissioner of Police is sitting here. So, yeah, perhaps you can remind me what you are doing. Which are the guys? Sorry. Something, its system is restarting or something. I hope it's not transfer. Oh, it's gone. Finally. Promised. Yes. I'm fortunate to have a very, open audience. Thankful for that. Open source, no. It's too buggy nowadays. I've got a very brief presentation. It's a very heavy topic and I'll be skimming over the surface, but I hope I'll be able to give you some food for thought. Basically, it is data flow analysis techniques to evaluate data leakage risk. It's slightly elaborate. The point was this entire IT 2020 of GSI is based on information security and big data. You've heard quite a few industry stalwarts speak on big data and some speaking on information security. I thought about a topic that will merge them both. So, information risk areas in big data and the analysis techniques for that. So, it's more like a merger of both. Okay, the first thing, moving into the problem statement. Data, now this everybody knows, so I'll just jump over it. Data has business value in all its form, in whichever state it may be, and whosoever may be using it or not using it at that particular time. Now, with the increasing outsourcing, more people having hands-on access to the data, and there is data going outside, there's third party people coming inside, everything getting connected. Yes, so that becomes a huge, huge problem. Now, jumping into the problem, which is big data. So, of course, the first time you heard about it earlier, the sheer quantum of data, I don't think I need to elaborate about the three V's. I think there is this gentleman on the first day, I think first show, he spoke about, from Messenger, I believe, who spoke so well on big data, and he elaborated on the three V's. I don't think I should be going into that again. So, big data, unique characteristics, the whole thing, big data, everybody speaks about it. So, basically, it is huge volume. There is a huge three V's, huge volume. There is a huge velocity. So, it's not just terabytes and terabytes of data or petabytes of data, gathered over a few years' time, but there is a huge velocity of data that is entering into the system, and the third is also the variety. So it's not just if you've got a RDBMS running into maybe 100 gigabytes or terabytes or something like that, it doesn't mean that it is big data. It may not necessarily be big data. So there are, I've heard some people say, okay, if it exceeds 5 terabytes, it is big data. If it exceeds 500 terabytes or enters 1 petabyte, it's big data. Not necessarily. If it is lot of data gathering over a period of time in a very rush velocity, and there is a huge amount of variety in it. So it's not just an RDBMS, there is a flat file, there is Excel, there is Word, and somebody spoke so well about even the streaming video that is coming in, there is user behavior pattern coming in, there are logs being generated. So there's a huge variety of data that is being generated, and that can get classified as big data. Now, securing big data for the very same reasons becomes extremely more challenging than what you would see in your typical traditional environment where everything is controlled and there is a CMS or there could be an ERP that is running and things are much more structured and managed out. Here there is so much data spread over such a huge area that the risk increases exponentially. Familiar threats have bigger impact in the big data environment. So there could be, okay, the same antivirus, the same mobile phones, the same ransomware, but when big data enters the scene, the complications are magnified in an exponential manner. The same common risk factors, as you will always see, whether there is mobile devices, clear text email, it could be bring your own devices type, it could be system breaker that somebody actually hacks into a system, it could be insider threats, passwords. Everybody is familiar with this. Now let us just see how it evaluates per se to the big data environment. Risk number one. Now I know that I'm rushing over it because, as you're all aware, the session is running like quite a bit late. So you'll have time for Q&A. So if you have any Q&As, you can always, I'll pick it up on that. Now, risk number one, there's a loss or theft of mobile phone. Now, everybody is aware, if you lose data on it, okay, you may lose some identity part of it. But in the big data environment, where it could be your mobile phone could be getting exposed to a part of the big data landscape, so that any sort of compromises on that behalf can have exponential effects on the organization, because the amount of data, the spread out of data, is no longer limited to your laptop, or sorry, it's no longer limited to one or two databases in a server farm. The impact is exponential. Technical controls are available, but maybe unevenly applied or sometimes misconfigured. BYOD, as you know, the gentleman in the ransomware part also mentioned, is, in my opinion, the single largest threat. You cannot even stop people from using mobile phones, from using it for even official purposes, browse, email. Now, ask yourself, how many of your organization? I can see most of you sitting over here are large companies. How many of you actually have a good MDM system, mobile device management policy, process and system in place? Hardly any. If at all, still it is in an unstructured. Some are being controlled, some are not being controlled. Some are being controlled in some manner, some still have some open edges here and there. And in many companies, as Mr. Shukla also pointed out very well, enforcing becomes a key issue. Why will they agree? They will not agree, they will revolt. So BYOD again remains the single largest challenge, even in the big data environment. Risk number two, clear text email. And this is one of the frequently asked questions. Give us a sound, like we are a consulting company and we work on so many of these systems. People call us for advisory basis and they say, how, internet is there, how could email be so, insecure as you guys propose to be? Because then I point them back to the entire inception of email. Email, browsing and stuff, this was a college project in the UCLA. This became a worldwide phenomenon. When those college students made a college project, which is the internet, they never had, security was the last thing on their mind. And now that very media is being used for accessing almost everything within an organization. And that leads to bigger challenges. Now, if you are having something, your service hosted on Gmail or something, you cannot not use SSL. But in most of your companies where you are having email systems personal to your organization, how many of you actually have implemented any sort of encryption end to end? Email data is always passing in clear text until encrypted, and most of the companies are not having that in place. Matter of fact, even for our company, because looking at the challenges with email, we even have a portal that any sort of documentary exchanges with our clients, it happens to the portal. Nobody emails anything. It happens to the portal. So the same challenges overlaps even to the big data environment. The huge phenomenal amount of data spread across the organization. Understand, big data, one of the key requirements of big data, when you can say you have big data in place, it's not just the volume, it's also the variety. So if you got one database or a couple of databases running into a couple of petabytes, it doesn't automatically mean that you have big data in place. The variety of data, as far as media, as far as structure and nature is concerned, also has to be there. Risk number three, system break-in. That is somebody hacks into your system. Theft of data, theft of funds. Motives may vary, but the bottom line is always the same. Ransomware, again, is one of the key areas in which people are breaking into the system, and very, very difficult for a firewall or a, you know, IPS system to detect it. Insider risk. Now, I'd like to spend a couple of minutes on this. Like, we, many of the faces I see of here are familiar because most of them are clients. And being a consulting company, we have access directly up to the CEO, we talk to the board of directors, and we give our advisory. But the point is, we can, I cannot, even though I run this company, I cannot just go and plug my laptop into anybody's, UTP port or latch onto the wireless. It's simply not possible. But even the lowest class employee who joined as a trainee will have much more access to the data than an outsider will ever have. Matter of fact, as per Forrester Research, you can look it up. Are you aware how much risk is there in your organization from a hacker coming into your organization? It's almost 4%. Breaking directly into your system. Across the entire risk, it's only 4%. Something like a virus or something helping, you know, break down your system or thief out your data, the risk is 16%. And you know how much is the risk for insider threats, where somebody whom you know within the organization taking the data out? 40%. 40% for Forrester Research. So insider threat, especially in these areas, and nowadays laptops with 1 terabyte is very common. I remember, you know, back in the mid-90s, my eldest sister, she was working for, I can see Mr. Dallo smiling, you can understand what I'm saying. That there is, my sister came home and she was working for a textile firm. She was saying, why, you know, my boss, he bought a 1 gigabyte hard drive. And I still remember the thought in my head, 1 gigabyte? What is he going to do with all that space? Seriously, I'm not making this up. This was mid-90s. I had like 94, 95. So. 1 gigabyte. Come on. My phone has like 96 gigs on it. So, with the exponential growth, anybody now, it's very common to see somebody using a company laptop having a mobile phone attached to it for charging purposes or whatever be the case. Very easy for an insider to take, siphon off the data. And now, what is the security in most companies? Some guard standing outside frisking your bag like this? Max. Or okay, are you taking a printout? Why the hell will you take a printout out? When there's so many easier ways to take the data out.